Welcome back to Brock's Garage. We're on season two. This is the first edition show of season two. And man, it's going to be an awesome one. Thanks for everybody for watching season one. We are on location in Gig Harbor with our friend Rob Sweet, who's got one hell of a kick-ass car and a story to tell. Rob, thanks for having us here at your shop. I appreciate that. And so tell us about this iconic car, man.
Well, it's a it's not a kit car. It is a hand-built car by Eric Broadley of North American GT40. And it is a direct copy or replica, if you will, of the original 1966 Mark I GT40, the same car that won the race in Le Mans 1966 and 68 and 69. So this car was built in 2004 by GT40 North America, and it features a hand-laid full carbon body and tub, and a monocoque frame. The engine is a 1969 351 Windsor that's been bored and stroked to 393 cubic inches and has a Renault R21 five-speed transaxle. The engine puts out a dyno-proven 560 horsepower, and the car, trust me, is a 200 mile an hour all day long car. It is an absolute blast to drive, and it does handle like a roller coaster. So one of these times, we're going to get everybody in it. Some of these guys, too tall, can't fit in it.
Yeah, we've already tried to get in it, and it's a tight fit, man. And once you get in there, it's pretty cool, but getting in there now, maybe it's because we're getting older or something.
Like it must be the age thing, but this is
awesome car.
This is the kind of car you just don't sit in and strap on the seat belts. This is the kind of car you wear. So when you get in, you put on the five-point harnesses, you are locked into this car, and that car belongs to you, and you're like one.
Oh, it's amazing feeling once you get in there. Now, the car is super, super light, and it's got this big, big motor in it, 500 horsepower motor, but the car weighed, what did you say, 2,000
pounds? 2,000 pounds.
Mm-hmm. And that's just amazing. And it's all carbon fiber, and it's just an amazing vehicle, man.
Thank you.
We're going to get some shots of it and whatnot, but... So tell us the story how you got it a little bit.
Well, the GT40 has always been my ultimate dream car.
Yeah, right? Your unicorn car, I call it.
Yeah, unicorn car.
Yeah.
And I figured, you know, you live once and you only get to drive down that road just once.
That's right.
And in life, I decided that it was time to get one. And went on the search and found a bunch of them, but they didn't have the details that I was looking for, such as the 8-stack fuel injection system like this car has. Most of them had just a regular Hawley 4-barrel. A little bit less performance. And with these cars, it's just iconic to have that 8-stack.
Oh, it looks impressive.
Yeah,
sure.
That's just the way
out,
it is.
Good.
Yeah, it does. So here's how I got the car. Ended up going through several iterations of GT40s, the DRBs, the Superformance, and they were just kit cars. They didn't have that one step higher.
Not the provenance you were looking for.
Yes, okay, exactly. So I found this car in Reno, Nevada, from a guy named Harry Swift, a really neat guy. And he was putting the car up for sale for somebody he was selling it for or had sold it to.
Oh.
Okay. So he had the car in the DuPont registry and was advertising it. I called him. He said, the car is still for sale. Here's the number that we need. And I said, sounds good to me. I like that number. And he said, well, okay, we can't do a deal right now because the car has to go through the auction because it was the star car. So I had to wait basically 2 weeks before we can consummate the deal.
Oh, wow.
So he said that he can't pull the car because it's his buddy's auction. And that's the backdrop that you guys saw in some of the pictures. Was Mag Auctions, and he said the car's got to go through, and he said I guarantee you it won't sell because he's gonna raise the reserve on it. And fortunately the car didn't sell, but it came very close to hitting the reserve,
which would have freaked you out.
I would have been bummed because he would have had to sell the car.
right, obviously.
So we got down there and loaded the car up, and just amazing. We went for a drive down outside of Reno, heading towards Fallon, and we got this thing up to about 120, and didn't even break a sweat.
It was built for.
Yeah, it was a blast. So really enjoy the car, and not many people get a chance
I've never seen one in person.
To see one, or let alone sit in one and drive one. So it was my first opportunity to drive one. Uh-huh. And I got to sit in a real one, chassis number P1017, which is a real Le Mans car. And when I sat and drove this one, you could tell the difference in the technology of the of back in 66 and the technology today.
Mm-hmm. So this is number one of how many you were saying?
Well, it was number one of supposedly 200 that were going to be built. And this is only one of six.
Wow.
And the six isn't even confirmed yet. And I can't find any sources from GT40 North America or even from Superformance, those guys that have the numbers on this car.
Man, that's amazing.
Pretty cool.
That is super amazing. So how long have you had it now?
Well, we got it first week of October, and only got a chance to drive it about 3 weeks before the rainy season came in.
Oh, wow.
And then it sits in here.
Yeah, you see that car going down the road.
You can.
You're just freaking out.
Yeah.
I mean, if you're any kind of car guy.
Well, the funny thing is, there's two stories that Harry told me, the guy I bought the car from. He says, number one, he says, be careful of people pulling out in front of you. They won't see you. He says, they are used to seeing these big, tall SUVs and full of kids screaming and stuff. So they look right over you.
Right.
And sure enough, the first day I had it out, some lady looked right over me. I could see her looking right past me. And she pulled right out in front of me, and I had to do a evasive maneuver, hit the brakes. It was not fun.
Well, you're in the right car for that.
And the other one, funny story, Harry says, when you gas it up, it's going to take you about four times longer to gas this car up than any other car you've ever owned.
Really?
I thought, is that because of the dual tanks? Because it has a tank on either side of the car. And he said, no, it's not because of that. He says, yeah, you'll be gassing up and people are going to pull up and, and block your way. And then they're going to come out and get pictures and videos and ask you all these questions. And sure enough, that 15-minute gas trip took me 45 minutes. He wasn't lying.
No, it happens to me in my Camaro a lot. So I know what you mean. Yeah,
as
same
it should,
kind of thing. Yeah,
it's
amazing. But it's part of the coolness of having something like that. Yeah,
it is.
It's such an awesome car.
Thank you. I enjoy talking to people about it and just being out on the road. That's what it's all about, is driving, right?
Yeah, it's an amazing car, and that's what you should be doing with it.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Here it is, man, the GT40. I never thought I'd ever see one in real life. Really, I appreciate it, Rob, having us here doing this.
Well, I know this is one of two that are in the local area. There's one in Shelton and then mine.
Right.
I don't know about Seattle, but...
So you said I could take it out and do burnouts?
Absolutely, yeah. You can do whatever.
I'm just kidding.
I'd like to see you go to McDonald's though and try and order a Big Mac.
I need to get in there. I mean, there's little windows. You can get a Happy Meal in there.
You can. Well, once you got your meal, you wouldn't be happy anymore.
I guess not. Well, you'd be happy to go there though.
Right.
Yeah, that's cool. So, Rob, everybody probably have seen the Ford versus Ferrari movie, and that was a really good movie. And this car is got the same lineage as that movie portrays, or what's the story on that?
Actually, it does. The whole story with the GT40 was that Ferrari was broke. They went racing and spent every penny that they had building the perfect race car. And Enzo himself said, can't keep this up, so maybe if we sold a portion of the company, like the street car portion, to somebody, we'd be able to afford racing. So Ford stepped in and said, we would like to make an offer on your company. And the talks got serious, and it came right down to the line where Ford Brass was sitting in Enzo Ferrari's office and were ready to sign the check. And Enzo Ferrari said, will I be able to have control over the racing section of this business deal? And Ford said, no, we're going to have control over everything across the board. And Enzo, being very competitive as he was, decided that was not going to be appropriate.
Yeah, and in these days, that racing was everything.
It was everything,
companies.
Yes. Yeah, because it was win on Sunday, sell on Monday.
Exactly.
That's what everybody believed in. That's what the mantra they lived by. So Ford got basically kicked in the teeth in this deal. And Ferrari pulled out, and a few years later ended up selling to Fiat for a larger sum of money. And Ford got jilted in... they wanted to come back the following year and dominate Ferrari and dominate the Le Mans race in Europe. And we had our own race, the Daytona, the 24 Hours of Daytona, and there was also Sebring as well. And those were the three biggest races that Ford wanted to dominate Ferrari in. So Ford set about building this car, this GT40 race car, for one purpose and one purpose only, and that was to dominate Ferrari, to insult Ferrari at their own home track. Mm-hmm. So it cost Ford hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars back then. Can't even amount.
Yeah, well, what it'd be today.
Yeah, insane. And the initial program got off to a very, very rocky start. They had problems with transaxles breaking. They had problems with brakes. They had problems with suspension and aerodynamics. So Ford couldn't overcome their issues. So they had to turn the program over to somebody else. And they actually turned it over to Holman and Moody and Carroll Shelby, because mm-hmm. they both had experience in endurance racing. So Carroll Shelby, being who he is, he won Le Mans in 1959 and was driver of the year in 1959. So he got one of these cars from Ford and test drove it, and Ken Miles being the lead engineer Bruce McLaren being the other one, they said the car is just absolute junk. It handles horrible. It has extremely unreliable transaxle. The Kaladi gearbox back then was just junk. So they started collecting all these better pieces and building these better pieces to make these cars reliable, because mm-hmm. that's what it was. You got to go.
Well, it's an endurance race.
Endurance race. Yeah. You got to go 24 hours of full throttle and full braking mm-hmm. Without breaking anything.
Yeah.
So that's the key, is to cross the finish line at the end of the 24 hours. So that is where these cars came from, strictly to beat Ferrari. That was their sole purpose. And for many years, privateers would come out and race these things and dominate, even years later, a decade later. And those cars are upwards of $10 million and higher if you want a real one. And they're very, very difficult to get. 107 were produced, wow. Mark ones. So that's when people started stepping up and making these kit cars mm-hmm. and these replica cars. And thankfully they do, because mm-hmm. normal people like us mm-hmm. can enjoy them now.
Yeah,
and
amazing car.
I love driving the car. It's just an absolute blast. It is something that you can't describe. You have to sit in the car and actually experience it, to hear that mid-engine sitting behind you, revving it up to 5,000, 6,000 RPM. It's an experience to behold.
That's got to be something crazy. Yeah. So you're a real Ford guy, though. I've noticed in your shop and talking to you that you're one of these iconic Ford guys.
That's not exactly true.
Really?
Yeah.
You holding out on me then?
Not kind of, I guess.
Okay, where's the Chevy stuff?
Well, it was a year and a half ago, I had a 40 Chevy coupe in here.
Oh,
and I had to do some paint work and some wiring too. But it just depends on the month. Sometimes I'll have nothing but Pontiacs in here. Sometimes I'll have nothing but Mach 1s.
Yeah.
It's just weird that
that's,
way.
That's March 1st for you, Lacey.
March 1st.
You'll know what I'm talking about.
Inside joke.
Yeah, it is. I told you that was a good one.
Right.
No, you got a really nice place here.
Thank you very much.
An amazing vehicle, and I really appreciate you sharing it with us. We're going to get some good video of it for everybody out there, and that's amazing. So, again, we appreciate you sharing this with us and everybody out there in YouTube land.
Quite welcome.
Getting a chance to see this piece of machinery here, which is awesome. And we're going to be on location in a lot of places this season. So if you want your car featured, we don't mind to travel a little bit if it's a really cool car. So get all of us through YouTube and all that stuff. And we've got shirts and cups and things for sale. People are buying those. And appreciate you guys doing that. Just get a hold of us and we'll get that hooked up with you. But yeah, we're going to go out and check this car out some more, and we'll be right back at you.
The best part.
Stay tuned. Yeah, this is the fun part. Stay tuned. More Brock's Garage.